Alright guys, we are back in my garage for another video, and today we're going to be taking a quick look at all of the sensors and everything we have going on in your B58 engine bay. I get a lot of you guys messaging me about codes that you see and different sensors that people are telling you to look at, but you don't know where it is, or maybe you're, you know, looking at the wrong sensor for your specific issue. And so I thought we could just do a nice overview of everything in your engine bay, especially because the B58 is so kind of compact and everything is really accessible and easy to see when all you do is pop your hood. So we're going to go ahead and look at my B58. I'll explain to you guys what the sensors are and what they all do, and just give you a little more insight into what you're looking at. So hopefully you guys find this video useful. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. All right, guys, so this is our B58 engine. This is pretty much what you should be looking at if you have a B58, although, of course, mine is pretty highly modified. So I'll try to explain where everything is in relation to the stock components. If there's something I've deleted, then I'll show you kind of where that reference should be. But otherwise, the overall layout is the same for pretty much all B58s. I would try to use my 440i, but it's even less stock than this one. So this is the best example that I have to show you guys what we're looking at. So to start off, let's look at the intake piping and how everything is kind of routed. So down here, you've got air coming in through our kidney grill. It gets routed through some ducting to our cold air intake. And yes, the stock intake is a cold air intake because it's pulling fresh air from the front kidney grill from outside of the car. Now, I have an aftermarket intake. There are a lot of different intakes that kind of fit the same design, but I highly recommend at least getting one with a heat shield so it blocks off the heat from the turbo and pulls as much cold air from the front of the car as possible. Then air gets sucked down into the intake, into the turbo, creates our boost pressure, and then it comes up through this charge pipe. The charge pipe goes directly into the intake manifold, so there is no front mount intercooler on these cars. The intercooler is built into the intake manifold right here, and then it gets pressurized air into our cylinder head, goes into the engine, comes out through the exhaust manifold on the turbo, and then the downpipe and out the back of the car. So overall, you know, pretty straightforward. The main difference from most engines is we don't have a front mount intercooler underneath the bumper. All of our intercooler stuff is done right here inside of our intake manifold. And if you have a stock one, upgraded one, it pretty much always has an intake manifold built into there. Now let's go ahead and talk about our sensors. So starting off back over here on the intake, our first sensor is the mass airflow sensor, also known as the MAF sensor. This measures the volume of air coming into the intake. So it tries to calculate how much fuel you should be using based on this reading of how much air is going into the engine. Now in our cars, for the Gen 1s, it's primarily used at idle and low load. Once you go full throttle, this isn't as much of a factor, but especially when you're cruising around town and things like that, this is a part of the fuel calculation so that the car can, you know, predict how much fuel you need to keep everything safe. Now on Gen 2s, this is actually a temperature sensor, so they've gotten rid of the mass airflow sensor, but there is still a sensor on the intake to help the car calculate how much air is going through the engine. Then as we go down, we have this hose that I've deleted for a PCV delete, but it is plugged in down at the bottom. A lot of people think that that's a sensor for the PCV system, but it's actually a heater. So there's a small heater in there, and especially when it's cold, it heats up this hose to avoid it from basically holding moisture and freezing, because that can cause cracks. So you're plugging in a heater on the PCV connection so that it can, you know, keep everything reliable. Now further down here, it's hard to see, but there is an electronic connection down here on the turbo, and that is your wastegate. So you have an electronic wastegate on the car. There are no pneumatic connections down here. It's not measuring boost based off of any reference. It's all electronically controlled through that plug, and the wastegate itself has a motor that opens and closes the wastegate flap. So all of that is controlled electronically by the DME. Now again, after the air comes out of the turbo, it comes up through this charge pipe, and we've got two sensors up here. This first one is a pressure sensor, so it measures how much pressure is going through your charge pipe. This is actually my favorite pressure sensor because it can actually measure up to, I think, 42 PSI. So this is a 4-bar. This is the one most of us are using if you have a custom tune with a big turbo kit and you're pushing over 30 PSI. These are the readings that you want to be measuring. Then we also have a temperature sensor, and this is measuring the temperature of the boosted air before it goes into the intercooler. So if you ever see like pre-throttle body intake temps or something like that, it's measuring this temperature. These are not IATs. These are temperatures before it goes into the intercooler. Now, once it goes through the intercooler, we have this additional MAP sensor right here. And this is a TMAP sensor, so it measures temperature and pressure. So this is measuring pressure going into the engine after it has gone through its losses and everything. It's measuring the temperature of the air after it's gone through the intercooler. This is like our final sensor to measure as accurately as possible what the actual engine is going to experience. Now keep in mind, this is a 2.5 bar sensor, so it can only measure 1.5 bar of positive pressure, which is unfortunate. It can't measure as much boost, so that's why a lot of times we lean on this sensor to measure pressure, because this one taps out at like 22 PSI. That's why this one isn't as ideal. When you max it out, it's just going to be a flat line going towards, you know, as boost builds, but this one will give you an accurate boost reading. Now, once the air is coming in here, there's a lot going on top of our valve cover. Again, I've got port injection and a lot of other stuff going on with my Motive Reflex, so ignore some of those wires. But some of the more important ones, one of course is going into our high pressure fuel pump. This is not a sensor for the fuel pump. It is a fuel quantity control valve. So what this does is it calculates again how much fuel you want to go into the car, and it adjusts the valve inside of the fuel pump so it controls how much fuel is actually being delivered to the injectors. So since this is a returnless fuel system, it tries to do its best job of calculating the correct amount of fuel and only delivering that much fuel so you don't have any excess that creates excess pressure or things like that. Also over here, we have our two O2 sensors. So the bigger connector is our front pre-cat O2 sensor. This measures our AFRs. And then the smaller one goes to our post-cat secondary O2 sensor. And this is primarily used to monitor cat efficiency as well as fuel trims. So these are our two O2 sensors and what they do. Now moving down here, of course, we've got all 6 coil packs. So we've got one for each cylinder. Underneath our coil packs, we have spark plugs. So you'll remove each of these by removing these E8 bolts. And then underneath, you can remove the spark plugs with a 12-point socket. On top of here, we've also got some additional sensors. This is our fuel pressure sensor. So this is what's measuring your rail pressure or your fuel pressure, depending on what your tuning software calls it in logs. It's coming from this sensor right here. We've also got our 6 injectors all the way along here. So that's where those go. Then we've got our intake and our exhaust cam sensor. So this is our exhaust cam sensor, and this is our intake cam sensor. There are actual wheels bolted onto the cams themselves, and these are taking readings off of those wheels that are on the cam. So both of these are the exact same sensor. If you have like an intake or exhaust position sensor issue, you can literally just swap these two and see if it follows it. And if it goes from intake to exhaust or vice versa, then you know the sensor itself is bad. So that's definitely pretty helpful. Now also up here underneath this rat's nest is our Valvetronic motor. So this is what replaces throttle body control on most modern, well, all modern BMW engines. This creates the variable valve lift. So the way that this works is it has a worm gear that attaches to an eccentric shaft. And as this turns, it basically turns that eccentric shaft, and that controls how much the valves open for, you know, every rotation of the engine. So if it opens more, it lets in more air. It basically replicates what you would experience with a throttle more open. So instead of this throttle body being our primary control for acceleration, it's this Valvetronic motor that controls how much valve lift we experience, which in turn controls how much airflow is going into the engine. The throttle body is still here kind of as a backup, but majority of what we see with the throttle body is boost control. So if this boost pressure reading is higher than what it should be, It reduces the throttle angle, that reduces how much air and thus how much boost is going into the intake manifold, and then you get a final reading of how much boost the engine is actually seeing from this sensor, as long as it's, you know, below 1.5 bar or 22 psi. Now down here, looking at the front of the engine, we've also got our temperature sensor right here. This is our lift point, so if you ever need to jack up the engine, you're going to hook it through here and either lift it with your engine hoist or, you know, whatever you need, but this is the main point that you're going to use for that. Now the main thing that I've removed from here is our EVAP system, and so this is kind of what it looks like. It plugs into the intake manifold here, and then there's another valve up here that I'll show you, but all these lines route back to the intake, and the intake pulls a vacuum on it so that you can get all of your fuel vapor out of the fuel tank. So it's basically taking out the excess gas and making sure we're not venting that vapor to atmosphere. I deleted it because this intake manifold deletes all the EVAP connections, but you'll have this on top of your charge pipe. This is a pressure sensor, so it's kind of monitoring pressure inside of your EVAP system, and it can tell you if there's an issue. You should not be seeing a whole lot of boost in here, so if something is damaged, then it'll probably be able to read that and tell you if something is wrong. Now, one thing I do still have on my 440, hopefully not for long, but this is the actual EVAP canister. So this controls where your EVAP gases are going. The line, again, goes down underneath the car and connects to the fuel tank. So any excess fuel vapor, not actual fuel, but just the vapor from, you know, empty gas in the tank, is going to be venting through here. It either goes down into the intake manifold if there's no boost pressure, or if it is experiencing boost, then it sends it through this line and back to the intake before the turbo, so it won't actually see any pressure inside the EVAP system. And then last but not least, so over here we've got a couple things. One, of course, is our DME. So these six plugs go into the main control unit for your engine. This does all of, you know, your tuning and controls for all of the engine systems. Then we also have the power supply control module. I'm learning a lot more about this, but basically it's a system that distributes power to all the auxiliary components and things. Then we've also got our coolant tank. So this main coolant tank is for your engine and for your turbo. The smaller coolant tank is for your intercooler as well as your air conditioner. So both of these get filled up separately. They are not connected. They control different systems. This one is called your high temp system because your engine and your turbo get a lot hotter. This is your low temp system because your intercooler and your AC don't get so hot. So that's why we keep these two separated. They both take 50-50 coolant or whatever blend you wish to run in your car. Now, one thing to keep in mind is only this system actually has a coolant level sensor inside of this tank. This one does not. So if you get a low coolant reading, it's going to be this tank. If you have like low power, your AC is blowing hot, or you know, you get code saying that your water coolant pump seems to be running dry, then it's probably this one. That's the only reading we seem to see. And actually, you can kind of see the water pump down here. That's the pump for the low temp cooling system. If you guys can see it, it connects to this hose that goes up to the intercooler in your intake manifold. But yeah, overall, that's everything that we've got to see here. Hopefully this answers any questions you guys might have. Of course, there's a lot more going on underneath the intake manifold and behind the engine and stuff, but this just kind of gives you an overview of what you're looking at and what everything does. So hopefully it gives you a better understanding of what you see when you take your engine cover off and do any work on your car. But let me know if you guys have any other questions or anything else that you're curious about inside of here. Hopefully this was pretty straightforward. And I think that's it for this video. So thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below.